Hello everybody, and welcome to the House of Nostalgia. Now this video that I'm doing today is about album covers and just how important they were to the recording artist's music. And since you're here, don't forget to like, comment, share, and subscribe to this channel. Now album covers did help play a small part in making musical artists a success. And that depends on how you use them. Even Master P took note of this forgotten detail when he created No Limit Records, and it helped make his record company a success in the 90s. The album cover was also used as your video back in the day, and it could tell the story of your music and how people use them to introduce themselves and their friends and family. No one ever bought an album back in the day without reading the album cover and the centerfold, if they had one, and even the sleeves were used for something. I watched the Marvelettes documentary on Unsung, and it was said that people loved their music but didn't know who they were because Black people was encouraged not to put their photos on the front of album covers back in the day. So their career seemed to suffer a little from that. So the Supremes were introduced through their first album when it came out, and people were able to get to know who they were. It's a lot of deep history behind album covers, and I studied just about everyone that I come across growing up in my home, but it was some that stood out to me the most. Now, I would like to start this off with the Ohio Players. You know, they were well known for their album covers, and these guys seemed to simply make album covers for men. Their first 1969 album cover, Observation in Time, didn't seem to do much for the band. It was like a bad introduction to such an amazing group. But they seemed to step it up with their next three album covers, which was like a album cover series called Pain, Pleasure, and Ecstasy. Now, this was different for 1972. I don't remember any of those album covers, but I do remember seeing the Skin Tight album cover. And they were onto something. You know, they began to have these sensual women on the front of their album covers, and it became their staple. Now, two of their other well-known album covers was the Fire album cover and the famous Honey album cover. The centerfold alone had people talking and everyone wanted to see it. Now, I remember hearing a terrible rumor in grammar school that the young lady passed away from the Honey clogging her pores. Now, thankfully, it wasn't true, but just about every album cover were of half-nude models. Parliament Funkadelic, they were known for their unique album covers, but it wasn't until their 1973 album cover, Cosmic Slop, that the covers started looking more polished than their earlier ones. Now, this was because of Chicago-based illustrator Pedro Bell. He was the reason for the majority of these outstanding album covers, and he did a lot of them. Now, one of my most memorable was the 1975 Mothership Connection album cover. Now, I don't think Pedro Bell created this particular cover, but we all know that it was a lot going on with this group, and it wasn't no shame in George Clinton's game back in the day. But it wasn't the front of the album cover that interests me the most. It was the back. They landed the mothership in the hood. And to me, I found that to be the most memorable part of this album cover. Most of the OJ's album covers were of them, but they had three memorable ones that caught my attention. The 1975 Survival album cover was of a disfigured face. It seemed to be someone's interpretation of surviving in these streets and reflecting it onto their face. Now looking at it, I see a tattoo. And that's what I see today. And the second one was the 1976 Message in Our Music album cover with the African musicians on the front. Now I would stare at this 1976 album cover, Ship Ahoy, and I just couldn't figure out what was the story behind it. Later, as I got older, I realized that it was slaves and a slave ship. And it's interesting how you get a different message from these covers many years later. Isaac Hayes' 1971 Black Moses album cover was very ambitious, and I must admit it was a little spooky to me at that time. I remember quite a few things after 1975, and I remember bits and pieces of things in the early 70s, but I didn't know what this album cover meant. It had an extended centerfold, and people would take the album sleeves, which was the Ten Commandments, and put them in his outstretched hands. Now, I thought they were tombstones a little later in life, but once I started learning the Bible, that's when I was able to see what he meant with all of this. This album cover was well thought out. James Brown 1974 classic album Hail had a memorable cover. Now, I don't remember any music from that album, but I do know that it was a heavily sampled album. I'm going to find songs from that album after I upload this video. The centerfold had Mr. Brown in one of his best designer suits, and everything written in the centerfold has the word Hail in it. And on the back of the album, he was walking unbothered through a den of demons, and they were afraid of him. They were saying, quote, "He's too strong. We can't stop him. That's because he's the Godfather," end quote. That was very memorable. Roy Ayers, My Life in the Sunshine, Everybody Loves the Sunshine, was a monster hit. This 1976 album cover was everywhere. My friend's parents had it in their home. This song is a classic. Even Mary J. had to bring it back in 1994. The vibrant yellow and white album cover, trimmed in black letters, give you a good feeling. You feel that you were about to hear some mellow music. It's giving you springtime, and the album was released in spring. Marvin Gaye's 1971 What's Going On album is a classic, and the album cover showed Marvin walking in the rain and thinking about all the negative things that was going on in the world at that time. The first time I saw the cover as a kid, I noticed the swing set in the back. I can't remember if this album had a centerfold, but I think I remember him sitting on one of the swings. The second album cover of his I remember was the Hear My Dear album. And this 1978 album and cover told a story about his ex-wife Anna and his present wife Jan. Now, this album was one of the critics' least favorite, but the story behind this album was that the proceeds from this album went to Anna. The album cover and song titles represent that. Now, some of the song titles, for example, were Is That Enough?, Falling in Love Again, Anger, You Can Leave, But It's Gonna Cost You, I Met a Little Girl. Now, Jan was 17 when she met Marvin, and he was still married to Anna. And some more titles was Anna's Song, When Did You Stop Loving Me?, When Did I Stop Loving You?, Probably When You Met Jan. Now, this album and cover was like a video. And of course, the 1976 I Want You album cover had the original famous artwork of the late Ernie Barnes. The front of War's 1973 The World is a Ghetto album cover had a lot going on. You have poverty, police, car towing, gangs, homelessness. The word ghetto was very popular to make into a song in the 70s. You had songs called The Ghetto, Clean Up the Ghetto, In the Ghetto, but War said the world is a ghetto. And this album cover fit right in with 2021. All is missing is cell phones and social media. I wonder what the group War think about this album cover now. Eddie Kendricks had success after The Temptations, and he had quite a few hits, but his 1972 album cover, People Hold On, had this bold blue color that made you stare before you even noticed the African chair and spear. It really make you think something is about to happen besides him singing a song. But of course, this was his one and only album cover like this. His solo career started taking off after the album, so they had to make him look more marketable. Diana Ross' first 1970s solo album, named after her, was strange to me. At first glance, I didn't think it was her, not at first. I just didn't understand what was the point of this album cover. It looked like her, but I honestly thought, no shade, that her body looked like a boy's body. She became super glam after this and never took another photo like this. And here's a few other album covers that got my attention in the 70s.